This morning we have seen that the formation of the solar system required a lot of time and with different stages, different episodes, which are collapse of the cloud, formation of protoplanetary disk, and after, of course, formation of the planet. So I will come back to this, but before I would like to give you a geological scale. The history of the Earth is divided in, let us say, four great periods. The first one is called Aden, and it started with the Earth's accretion. The second one, the end of the Aden and the beginning of the second one, the Archean, is 4 billion years. It corresponds to the oldest rocks that we know on the surface of the Earth. The Archean ends at 2.5 and begins Proterozoic times. So this is a big change in the Earth's history. Before 2.5, the Earth behaves in an archaic style. And after 2.5, we see a geodynamic style which is more modern and that looks like today. After the Proterozoic ends at 0.5 billion years, this is an explosion of life, at least big animals or plants, and of course, today, here. So the one of the problems is to know what is the starting point of the history, in the history of the Earth. So, of course, probably you know this kind of meteorites. These are CI chondrites, and they consist in chondrules, which are this rounded shaped pieces here. And these chondrules contain olivine, but also some minerals, just like pyroxene, iron, and glass. And this kind of chondrite is very interesting because their composition, if we accept the light elements here, their composition, when plotted against the solar composition, is the same. So that means that their composition is that of the primary solar system. So they are very primitive objects. So if we come back to this meteorite, so we have seen the chondrules, but there are also some inclusions that we can see here, these white inclusions. And these inclusions here, with a very, here, they are not rounded just like chondrules, they have a different shape. And if we look at the composition of this, here we have the meteorite itself, here we have this white inclusion. And if we look at the composition, in red we have magnesium, so these are the minerals just like olivine and pyroxene that we have in this meteorite. But in this inclusion we have mainly aluminium and calcium. So this is what is called the calcium-aluminium rich inclusions, which are also called CAI due to their composition. So these inclusions are very interesting because they are very refractory parts of the meteorite. If we look here at the scale is temperature. So this refractory inclusion crystallize, condense between 2000 and 2500 degrees, while metals at lower temperature and silicates even lower temperature. So they are among the first materials that crystallize in the solar system. And as the temperature of crystallization is higher than that of the chondrule, the age of the CAI is also, or should be, greater than the age of the chondrule. So, if we look, here is a lead-lead diagram, and if we look at the age of the CAI, here we have two samples, we have ages that are about 4.567 giga years for the CAI, And if we plot in the same diagram the control, they give a slightly younger edge, that is 4.564 gigahertz. So, okay, this chronological data, geochemical data, indicate and corroborate what we have seen in the meteorite itself, that is that the CAI are the older known material on the in the solar system until now, because they are older than the control here, not very much, but slightly older. So, okay, here are dating of different by different methods, isotopic methods, of this CAI and control, and in fact, the edge that now is considered as the starting edge for the solar system is this edge of 4.5682 billion years. So you can see this edge is produced with a very good precision. But in fact, there is some problem because, as we have seen, the formation of the planets lasts quite a long period of time. And this age of formation of CAI was probably taking place during the formation of the protoplanetary disk. So this age is slightly older than the beginning of the collapse of the protosolar disk. So this is not the real beginning of the solar system. And this age is younger than the formation of the planet as a world planet as we know today. So this age is older than the real age of the Earth. So we take this age as the beginning, as the age of the beginning, but in fact, the difficulty is to give a precise age for a mechanism that lasted a long period. The oldest rocks that we know are from Canada in Acasta area, so here in the northwestern territories, far to the north. And they outcrop on a very small place. Here is a small island, so the place where we can find these rocks is here. Okay, a few words of the outcrops. And of course, a Canadian geologist built a very beautiful house for geologists who work there, with something very important, the barbecue here. So these rocks, you can see these rocks here, and they are cut by a dike, which is a pegmatite, which is 3.6 billion years old. So the rocks are gneisses with a very nice foliation here. And in these rocks, there are zircon crystals here, who give ages around 4 billion years. The oldest one is 3036 million years. So this is the age of the crystallization of this rock. But a Japanese group work on these zircons, not exactly on the same rock, but on a slightly younger. And here is the zircon crystal. And the age is 3.9 gigayears. And if you look carefully at this crystal, there is a darker part here in the middle. And the dating of this part gives ages of about 4.2. That means, so this is some what we call inherited zircon. That means that, of course, the rock itself crystallized at 3.9 something. And when crystallizing, it was crystallizing from crystals that was in the rock before. That means that before this Acasta gneiss, it existed other rocks, other granite, that were totally destroyed, and only the zircon crystal survived. So this is very important, because this says that in this place, in Canada, at 4 billion years, we have the Acasta gneiss, but 200 million years before, we had a continental crust already existing in this place. That means that during the Aegean, there were rock of granitic composition. We do not know these rocks, they disappeared, they were eroded, they remain only as core of crystal zircons, but there were rocks older than this. So maybe you have seen this paper. This paper was published several years ago. That was in 2008. And they say that there is evidence for adiabatic crust. This is also in Canada, and they give ages of about 4.3 billion years. So the place is Nouvelle-Guitouc here on the Hudson Bay in Quebec province in Canada. And in this place, there are the outcrops are of very good quality, as you can see here. And we have sedimentary rocks here, and very special rocks, just like this one with a nice bonding, beautiful garnets. And if we look in detail, you have a biotite in black, a white amphibole here, and beautiful garnets here. So the problem with these rocks is that some people on the group with O'Neill, Jonathan O'Neill, published an age of 4.3 million years based on an isotope of neodymium 142. And first you can see that, okay, there is a line here, but more than a scattering of data. The data were more or less forced, I think, to obtain this result. But the problem is that when you use another isotope of neodymium 143, the age is 3.8. So on the same sample, depending on the isotope you will use, they obtain different ages. You have seen recently there were a lot of papers saying that in these rocks, when you look at zircon, there are no zircons older than 3.8 million years. So I think that no, most of the people think that this formation is not older than 3.8 or 3.9. Because the only evidence for old ages is based on one isotope, while the other one gives different results. Okay, so some people consider the Aden period as some kind of L, with a lot of meteorite falling down, magma ocean, and so on. And there is another school that considers that during that period, the Earth was cool with ocean, with continents. So we have two views of this period. And what I would like to discuss now is what is, I will not say what is a good one, but what can we think about this? So the first point is, you know, the Earth with a lot of shells. These shells are, of course, a solid core made of iron, a liquid core made of iron too, a silicate mantle here made of olivine and pyroxene, and around some crust that can be granitic or basaltic crust. So one of the questions is, what is when does the Earth acquire this shell structure? When does this appear? So the first question considers the formation of the core. And the dating of the core differentiation is based on an instant radioactivity, which is the decay of 182 hafnium in 182 tungsten. So the half-life is very short, 9 million years. And of course, that means that we can consider that the whole 182 hafnium totally disappeared before 60 million years. So this system will be excellent to try to date something that took place very early in the history of the planet. But this system has another advantage, is that hafnium is considered as what we call lithophile element, that is, that is incorporated in silicates. Hafnium will go in silicates, while tungsten is considered as siderophile element, and it will go into the metals. So we have a system that will behave in different way in silicates and metal. So let us try to have an example. if we consider that the core differentiation took place before 60 million years, that means that the whole 182 hafnium decay in 182 tungsten, and the whole tungsten will be in the core, in the metal. Now, if we consider that this event took place before 60 million years, of course, in this condition, only one part of 182 hafnium will have decayed into tungsten. And this tungsten, at the moment of differentiation, will move into the core. But it will remain some 182 hafnium. And this 182 hafnium will behave as a lithophile element and will go into the, will remain into the silicates. And while isolated into the silicate, it will decay in tungsten. So that means that if we found some 182 tungsten in silicates, that means that this event of core mantle differentiation took place before 60 million years. So of course, if I speak about this, this is because we found 182 tungsten into the mantle. So there is an excess of tungsten, of this isotope of tungsten, in the mantle. So that means that the event of differentiation between core and mantle took place less than 60 million years after the nucleosynthesis. But we can do more. I will show you a terrible diagram with time here and with a big break here. And here's the ratio between 182 and 183 tungsten. And so in this diagram, we can plot here the composition of chondrite, so the evolution of isotope in chondrite. Here is the content in the primitive sun. Here is the evolution of chondrite. And if we look at the mantle of Earth today, we have this value. So theoretically, if there was no separation between these two isotopes, the mantle value should be here. And in fact, it is here. So it's possible to calculate the moment of differentiation. And the moment of differentiation seems to be 30 million years. So it seems, if we look at this kind of diagram, that the differentiation between the mantle and the core took place extremely early in the history of the solar system, and probably 30 million years after the formation, the beginning of the formation of the solar system. So there are some limits for this method. In the best case, we have this reaction and only this reaction. On the moon, we know that 181 tantalum plus neutron can give 182 tungsten. That means that there is some 182 tungsten that has a cosmogenic source. And also, we made, for doing this, we make the assumption that the 182 hafnium divided by 180 hafnium is constant in the solar system. This is a reasonable assumption, but this is no more than an assumption. So, okay, I speak about this just in order to say that the age of 30, well, there is a wide probably error around this. But what is sure is that this event took place extremely early in the solar system, less than 60 million years after the beginning formation of the solar system. So here is the Earth, and you know, today in the Earth, the convection in the outer core, there is a convection, and this generates magnetic field. So, of course, in order to have a magnetic field, we need to have a core. But this is not because we have a core that we have a magnetic field. So one of the questions is, when does the magnetic field appear on Earth? So magnetic field could have could be important for development of life or not, but because it provides a protection of the Earth against the solar wind. So if we look at the, here is a strength of magnetic field, here is time, here are some measurements made on rocks, and on the measurements made on rocks, we can see that the older magnetic field is at 3.6. Recently, in 2015, some additional measurements were made on zircon crystals that we can find in, I will speak about this, in Australia, in Jack Hills. And this additional data indicates that the magnetic field on Earth existed at 4.2 million years. So, okay, the magnetic field appeared quite early. We'll see that it will be difficult to go more back in time because there are no more materials that can record the magnetic field. So there is something like that. Another point is that if we look on, you know, this is not the Earth but Mars, and some people have seen that there are traces of remnant magnetism in the rocks from Mars surface, but only in the very old rocks, older than at about 3.5 million years. That means that on the planet Mars, the magnetic field also appeared very early in the planet. Okay, just for the picture, it's not for me. So, now we change a little bit. So we have seen that something happened, the differentiation appeared very early on the planet. Now we will look at the moon. And the moon is interesting because there is no plate tectonics. So the rocks and the structure remain since the beginning of the history of the satellite. And of course, in addition, on the moon, some people could, some geologists went and took samples. If we look at the surface of the moon, there is a large area covered by white rocks, just like here. These rocks, as an ensemble, are white, okay? And they are mainly made of crystals of plagioclase. And their composition, if we look at rare earth elements here, lanthanum to ytterbium, have this kind of low content with a positive anomaly. Now, if we look at the black rocks here, these black rocks are basalts. They, from microscopic point of view, they contain plagioclase and pyroxene. And their composition is exactly the opposite. They are rich in rare earths with a negative anomaly at the level of europium. So very early in the mind of the researcher who worked on this, they consider that these two kind of rocks were coming from a unique composition with a flat pattern like this that differentiate into some part enriched in rare earths and one part impoverished in rare earths. So I will try to explain this more. But about the moon, the idea was that this differentiation was possible only in a magma. And they developed the idea of a magma ocean. So that means that the surface of the moon was, not the surface, but on great depth, the moon was molten. And of course, the energy necessary for melting of the moon was the kinetic energy, the transformation of kinetic energy from the impact into thermal energy, energy released by the iron silicate separation, of course the decay of radioactive elements, and maybe tidal heating. But what is interesting, of course, this magma ocean has to crystallize because now the moon is not liquid, it's a solid. And if we look at the mineral that can crystallize on the moon, you can see here a lot of minerals able to crystallize, and I put here the density of these minerals. And here's the density of the magma, 2.85. We can see that almost, no, it's not A5. Yes, this is. You can see that all the minerals have density greater than the density of the magma. All the minerals, if they have a greater density, will sink, except plagioclase, which has a lower density. And if the density is lower, it will float. So that means that the formation of the moon or the differentiation of the moon is explained by this mechanism with high density minerals, just like olivine and pyroxene, that sink at the basis of the magma ocean, and plagioclase accumulate, so accumulation of plagioclase that float and form the crust of the moon. So if we start with a magma ocean homogeneous with this composition, we can evolve towards anorthositic, so a plagioclase crust with this kind of pattern, and a lower mantle in the moon with this kind of pattern. So that means that these two kinds of pattern derive from a single pattern, flat like this at the beginning. So the moon results of a differentiation of the magma ocean. So we can see that anorthosites are almost everywhere on the surface of the moon. That means that the event of differentiation of anorthosite is not a local event, but a planetary event, an event that affected the whole planet. Another thing is that if we look at the edges of the anorthosite, they are more or less 4.4 something million years. So what about the Earth? And as I told you, on the Earth, there is a plate tectonic that erased everything if this happened. Some people calculated that if the gravitational energy released by accretion was totally integrally, which is not the case, of course, transformed into thermal energy, the temperature would have been sufficient for melting the moon, but also the Earth, and to give a magma ocean. One of the problems is that the gravitational acceleration on the moon is by far lower than on the Earth. That means that if on the moon you can, because plagioclase is a mineral that can crystallize only at low pressure. So if on the moon you can crystallize plagioclase on a thickness of magma ocean of 165 kilometers, on the Earth only on 27 kilometers. So we do not expect to have had anorthosite on the Earth, because the thickness of the magma ocean on which you can produce this is too small. But on the Earth we have another kind of rock. Maybe you have heard about this, these are komatiites. These komatiites are ultramafic rocks that were extremely hot. The temperature of crystallization of these rocks is 1,700 degrees, while the temperature of crystallization of basalt today is higher is 1,450. So at least 250 degrees higher than today. And they crystallize giving some acicular olivine. What we found on Earth, here is a diagram with a ratio of rare earths, and here aluminium titanium. We find on Earth that before 3.4 billion years, we have a very wide range of composition for this komatiite based on this element. And while after 3.4, all the komatiite on Earth give a very homogeneous composition, just like this one. So the interpretation of this is that before 3.4, the mantle of the Earth, because these komatiites are generated by melting of the mantle, before 3.4, the mantle was heterogeneous, while after 3.4, it became homogeneous. Okay, so some researchers, two groups, Jackson Carlson and Boyer and Carlson work on the extinct radioactivity 142 neodymium, and they show that on the Earth, all the rocks have the same isotopic composition or characteristics, which is called the Earth standard, all plot in this range, except very old rocks from Isuak that are 3.87 Nuvagituk, the same age, and Akasta, 4 billion years. So they show that there is a complementary behavior with rocks depleted and rocks enriched in these isotopes, but this heterogeneity appears only in the oldest rocks, not in rocks younger than 3.8. So their conclusion is that the Earth's mantle preserves traces of the primary differentiation. Okay. So one of the problems on Earth, as I told you, it's not possible to crystallize huge amounts of plagioclase. And instead of plagioclase, on Earth, the mineral that crystallized was garnet. And garnet is a very heavy mineral that also sink in the mantle. So on the Earth, the crystallization was crystallization of pyroxene, olivine, and garnet, and everything, all these minerals, sunk at the bottom of the magma ocean. Okay, I do not speak about the crust. So the idea about the Earth is that there was a magma ocean. Most of the people consider that the thickness of the magma ocean was more than 1,000 kilometers. So it's something very deep. So there was, before 4.4 billion years, there was crystallization of garnet, pyroxene, olivine that accumulate at the bottom of the magma chamber. And, okay, and before 3.4, convection took place, mixed everything, and of course, depending on the place of the mantle that melted, we obtained the different kinds here, the different kinds of komatiite. After 3.4, okay, after 3.4, here the convection mixed everything, and we return. After 1 million years, we return to homogeneous mantle, and we observe here the very homogeneous composition of this komatiite. Just to say that, of course, if we consider that the magma ocean appeared very early, this is a system that is very favorable for the separation of iron, because we can consider, when we were speaking about the formation of the core, iron can migrate between. So if we look at the Earth, here is you have a lot of chemical elements, and here is a value for the primitive mantle. If we look at the composition of the continental crust, its composition is this. So it is enriched in some elements, just like rubidium, barium, thorium, and so on. And of course, the resulting mantle will be depleted. So if you start with this, and that you extract this, the mantle will be impoverished in these elements. So the idea was to look at the composition of rocks derived from the mantle in order to see if the mantle was already affected by extraction of continental crust. And if we look here at neodymium isotopes, again time, against time, here is a chondritic composition, that means the composition without differentiation. And if we look at the oldest rock, Akasta, Isua, and so on, we can see that we already have values that are different from the chondritic values, from the chondritic reservoir. So that means that these rocks, the oldest rocks that we know at the surface of the Earth, were formed from an already depleted mantle. So a mantle whose composition has changed by extraction of early continental crust. So this is true for neodymium, but the same for strontium or hafnium isotopes. So some proof of this are given by Zirkin, crystal. So maybe you don't know zircon. Zircon is a silicate of zirconium. It is extremely resistant to weathering. It's a very resistant mineral, resistant to melting, very high temperature of melting, and of course, it contains uranium and thorium and not lead. That means that this mineral is very easy to date. And maybe you can see here the effect of these radioactive minerals. Here is a biotite crystal. Here is a zircon crystal. And here is the effect of radioactivity on the structure of the biotite. So this is due to the disintegration of uranium and thorium contained in zircon crystal. And here also, just a zircon crystal in quartz. And of course, when you transform uranium into lead, the ionic radius increase. I think it's a point 94, I think, for uranium, and for lead is 130 something. So that means that the size of the crystal increase when you transform uranium into lead. So this makes these cracks that you can see around. Okay. So you certainly know about this. In Jack Hills, in Australia, in Western Australia, there are some sediments that you can see here. And these sediments are, I don't remember exactly the age, but 3.8 billion years. And they contain zircon crystal, just like this one. And these zircon crystals give ages of 4, 3, 5 million years. And even one sample here gave an age of 4.4. So this age are obviously Hadean ages. This age are not, we do not know the rock in which this zircon crystallized. They are in a younger rock, so they crystallized probably in a granite. The granite was eroded, altered, weathered, and only the zircon, which are resistant, remain and were conserved in sediments. And this is the place where we found this zircon. So, okay, the oldest rock on the rock is agasta gneisses, but the oldest material are these zircons. But the rock in which the zircon crystallized has disappeared. This age of 4.4 is, maybe you have seen in the literature, is discussed because it is located near a crack. It's, here you can see a crack in the crystal, and people say maybe this is an artifact and so on, but this age is sure. In fact, the population of zircon in this Jack Hills sediments give a very wide range of ages, most of them between 4.1, but you can see until 4.4 here. And something interesting, here are some of these crystals. And zircon is a mineral that will crystallize in a magma. And of course, it doesn't crystallize alone. There are other minerals crystallizing together with him. And sometimes it will include, just as you can see here, some minerals that were crystallizing together with him, with it. And for instance, we can see a lot of quartz crystals in inclusion, but we can see also plagioclase here, biotite here, and so on. So if we look at the minerals included into this zircon crystal, we can have an idea on the other minerals that were crystallizing together with zircon. And of course, these minerals, you learn at school when you were young, that quartz, feldspar, and mica is a composition of a granite. So that means that these zircon crystals crystallize in a granitic magma, and the granitic magma is a composition of the continental crust. That means that the continental crust existed very early, as early as 4.35 or 4.4 million years. So this was a very important point, very early, probably less than 200 million years after the formation of the planet, after the accretion, continental crust existed on the surface of Earth. Something also interesting is that there is zircon can incorporate in its chemistry some amounts of titanium. And the amount of titanium depends, that it can accept, depends on the temperature. So here is the amount of titanium and here is the temperature. So if you can measure the amount of titanium in zircon crystal, you can have its temperature of crystallization. And the result was extremely surprising because we imagined that on the early Earth, we expected very high temperature. And in fact, the temperature of crystallization was very low, 680, 750. So these zircons are very old, but they crystallize at low temperature. This has also some consequences. Here is a pressure temperature diagram. Here is a dry solidus for a granite. That means that if we have no water in the system, here we have solid and here we have solid and liquid and crystals. But if we have water, here we have solid and here we have liquid and crystals. So you can see that water decreases significantly the temperature of beginning of melting of a granite. If no, in this diagram, we plot the range, the temperature range for crystallization of zircon crystals, we see that this temperature is only consistent with hydrosmelting. So that means, of course, you will say, we have seen that the minerals in inclusion are biotite, muscovite, so these are hydrous minerals. But that means that water was available during the genesis of this granite. So this is a very important point. So, okay, the same here. Another point is that some people work, and this is a group of Valais, work on oxygen isotope. So here are the value of zircon, stable in equilibrium with the mantle composition. And the value measured in the zircon from jackals are significantly higher than the mantle values. And there is only one possibility to obtain this high isotopic value is to have low temperature hydrothermal alteration. That means that the source of this granite interacted with low temperature liquid water. So that, once again, water was available at the surface of the Earth. Once more, you like isotope. So lithium isotope here. Here are the mantle value, and here are the values of the jackals zircon. So, of course, they give a widespread value with very low, very negative values, up to minus 18. If we compare these values with the values of, let us say, Archean granite here, zircons in Archean granite, we see that the zircon in mass of granite plot near the mantle value. We do not have this low value that we observe in jackals. Now, if we plot the modern continental crust with fresh samples, we have the same concentration around the mantle value. And if we plot here the modern continental crust but with altered samples, so that means that interact with water, we can see that we have a dispersion of the values with negative, strongly negative value. So this is also an argument used to say that the zircons from jackals, or the rocks from which the zircon crystallized, had interacted with water. Just like what we can see in modern rocks altered, weathered by by wizard, by rain and so on.
Excuse me, Harvey, do you have any idea how water separates these isotopes of lithium?
No, I have no idea. Okay, just something to, as we are trying also to speak about life. In some of these zircons, some people found graphite. Maybe you have heard some people found diamond that was published 6 or 7 years ago. And in fact, they realized that the diamond was the diamond used to polish the thin section. So, and it's not really included in the zircon crystal. But graphite is exists. And of course, graphite is carbon. And it's possible to measure the isotopic composition of carbon. So this was done already on rocks from Greenland here. And this has been done last year on carbon in Jekyll's crystals. So if we look schematically, inorganic carbon gives this range of values here. And organic carbon gives this range of value. So in this paper, people conclude that they fall in the place where there is no inorganic carbon. So this signature should be organic signature. So that means that probably life existed at this period. This seems presented like this, it seems wonderful. There is only one problem, is that if the rocks are metamorphosed, so if they go deep into the crust and the intervent high pressure, high temperature, these processes will modify the isotopic signature of carbon. And these rocks, at least this one, are strongly metamorphosed. So maybe metamorphism can transform an inorganic signature into an organic-like one. Of course, we do not know for Jekyll zircons because we only have the mineral, but probably the story is the same. So what is important for life is that we have seen that during this period, the ADN, between 4.4 and 4, we had continents and we had water. I will not discuss about the origin of water. Tomorrow you will have a lecture about the origin of water on Earth.
What you are doing in your office?
Okay, so I will finish speaking about something that is outside of the field of my specialty, is about giving some words about the late heavy bombardment, and I suppose most of you know better than me. You know that a lot of objects in the solar system, objects that doesn't have plate tectonics and so on, are covered with a lot of impact crater. Even small object, just like Eros asteroid. And if this is a classical diagram made for the moon, if I plotted here the number of crater impact with a certain some size against the time, we found that most of this impact crater have edges younger than 4 billion years. So they seem to draw a very nice curve here, like this. And the problem is to know what happened before. So what happened before, maybe we can extrapolate the curve like this. And of course that means that the density or intensity of the bombardment, of meteoritic bombardment on the very early Earth was greater than what we see on the moon. So probably, certainly the ADN was something like that. But there are a lot of arguments against this, because if we go back in that direction, the amount of material provided to the surface of the moon would made the whole moon at 4.1 And we know that, of course, the event of moon formation took place earlier. And the alternative theory is a theory of cool early Earth here, which says that after the accretion, the intensity of meteoritic bombardment decreased extremely rapidly, that during the Aden, so with this kind maybe of Earth, we had the intensity of bombardment was not very much more than during the Archean, and that there was an event, very short, few hundred million years, but very short event at that time here. So that means this is very different, because that means that the Earth during the Aden, if we follow this line of assumption, the Earth was with ocean, continent, and not a very strong meteoritic bombardment. So maybe potentially inhabitable. Show you this. So here is a comparison between here the structure of the solar system with only the giant planets here, and here what is supposed to be the position of the planet with a which are closer to the sun before the late heavy bombardment, with a disk of planetesimal that was very important. And what happened in this system? Jupiter was slowly migrating towards the center, towards the sun, Saturn in the other direction, and there was, after a moment, there was a resonance between the two planets, and of course, they change their orbit and take this configuration. So probably you have already seen this one. But this is something good for the speaker, because you have to wait until 800 million years. So you have Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and planetesimals here. Good for rest.
Is my face that appears?
Have you seen something? So okay, the situation at the beginning is supposed to be something like that. Just when they enter, when Jupiter and Saturn enter in resonance, the situation was this one, and immediately, following this model, when they enter in resonance, of course, Neptune and Uranus migrate towards the external part, and of course enter into this belt and provide this kind of thing with ejection of a lot of planetesimal outside, but also in the inner solar system. So if we try to discuss this, on the moon, it seems that there are evidence of this late heavy bombardment. If we consider that 3.9 and 4 is the maximum age for lunar melted rocks melting due to the shock of meteorite. The old lunar crust, that means the anorthosite, is preserved on very huge surfaces of the moon. And if we had intense bombardment during 500 million years, this crust should have been totally destroyed and molten. The lunar crust has not been significantly contaminated by siderophile element, and meteorite brings to the Earth siderophile element. What about Earth? Okay, on Earth we know that A crust has been preserved at the surface of the Earth since 4.4 or 3.5. What does this mean? This means that in order to have destruction of the crust and sedimentation, you need to have a stable crust. So that means that there was, at 4.4, a stable crust at the surface of the Earth, and the argument is more or less the same as for the Moon. This crust should have been destroyed in case of a permanent bombardment during 500 million years. We have also evidence recorded in the zircons that the water was stable. And if a real, very heavy bombardment took place during 500 million years, this ocean would have been vaporized. And we have in the rocks, in the zircon, record of the presence of water. Some rocks, among the oldest supracrustal rocks, show platinum element, platinum group element anomalies, and some also isotopic anomaly consistent with meteoritic contamination. The problem on Earth is that we do not know shock quartz crystals, which are very common under meteoritic impact. And in Ishua, so the same as here, people doesn't found any chromium isotopic anomaly that should have been characteristic of this bombardment. So we'll finish now by trying to see what could have been the implication of what we have seen with life. If we consider the early Archean time, so before 4.4, we had a magma ocean. There was no magnetic field. Probably it was too warm, too hot to have liquid water. So probably there was no possibility for emergence of life and even for prebiotic chemistry. I have difficulty of thinking in a prebiotic chemistry in a magma ocean. But after 4.4 up to 4 billion years, we have seen that we had continental crust, that liquid water was present, so that there was an ocean. In addition, there was a magnetic field. So the conditions were favorable for the apparition of life. I do not say that life existed at that time. We have no proof, no evidence, but conditions were favorable for the emergence of life. Water, continents, and magnetic field. And after, of course, during the Archean, I said nothing about the Archean, but in the Archean times, we know stromatolite, we know fossils and so on. So the conditions were not only favorable for life, but for the apparition of life, but also for its development and its evolution. So there is only one point, is what was the efficiency of the late heavy bombardment. And you know the discussion about this, and I have no answer, but was it extremely strong enough to vaporize all the ocean and, of course, to sterilize Earth if life appeared before? Or was it only, I would not say a weak heavy bombardment, but not so strong? This is what many researchers think now, and not strong enough to vaporize the whole ocean and so on. And in this case, if life appeared before, maybe it could have continued after. Okay, I think